Welcome to Mintel's Little Conversation podcast.
Welcome to Mintel's Little Conversation, where our experts bring you fresh ideas and new perspectives on how consumers eat, drink, shop, groom, and think. I'm Edward Bergen, consultant specializing in food and drink. I'm an all-round foodie, and I am a massive hummus fanatic, as always. So today's podcast is a contentious one. We're going to talk about the topic of how brands, more than maybe in the past, are taking a stand on various different issues. We're going to start with a few factual examples, and then I'm going to just talk about it a little bit. So the first one is, we've got a new GB News opinion-led channel in the UK, and a whole host of brands like Copperberg Cider have said they don't want to put their advertising on the channel. Quite recently, Unilever brand Ben & Jerry's announced ending of ice cream sales in the Palestinian territories. Gillette previously targeted toxic masculinity and changed their ad slogan to the best a man can be from a best a man can get. And Nike partnered with Colin Kaepernick, who took the knee during the US national anthem in protest to racial injustice and discrimination. All different issues, quite various. And we're going to talk about them and, you know, the topic in general. And we have some great experts, great guests with us. So I'm not going to say more about them, but in that order, you know, Sarah, Johnny and Adia, can you introduce yourselves?
Sure. Hi, everyone. I'm Sarah Jindal. I'm Associate Director of Global Beauty based in the U.S. And I'm glad I'm here. I'm glad that I got asked, Ed, to do this because I think everybody knows me by now that I'm pretty honest about a lot of these issues. And we cover them quite a bit on the platform on the beauty side.
Hi, I'm Johnny Forsyth, and I work on the global food and drink business. And I'm very intrigued that you've invited me along here, Ed. I think it's probably because you know that I'm very contrary. I look forward to the show.
Hi, everyone. I'm Adia Baker. I am the Global Diversity Manager for Mintel, and I'm here to give the organizational perspective and kind of the general accountability view of these various brands and companies. So I'm really excited to be here as well.
I'm so excited for this one. Okay, we're going to start with Mintel. We start with consumers, as always. We understand what consumers want and why. We've got a lovely stat, which is nearly two-thirds of US consumers say that they prefer to be associated with companies and or brands that align with their values. So straight off the mark. So I guess the first question to all of you, you know, who goes first? Maybe Sarah, I actually think you should kick this one off. Can we talk about the consumer? Do they want brands to take a stand? Do they care? Is it important?
I mean, they say yes. I mean, obviously from that stat, you've got over 60% of consumers in the US that say, I want to shop from brands that align with my values. So they're coming out and they're saying that, but then, you know, as we know on kind of our side of the business, consumers generally can say one thing and oftentimes tend to do something a little bit different because I think the convenience factor always comes into play. The price factor always comes into play. Availability comes into play. So I think while the desire is there and that desire is definitely growing, are they able to easily and in a convenient way put that into action? So, and again, you know, when we talk about a lot of these stats, we're making very broad general statements, right? So if you kind of dig into some of that data and look at the demographics, you might actually find that that number is higher when you're looking at younger consumers like Gen Z, who tend to be quite, you know, switched on top of a lot of these issues, quite active when it comes to kind of social issues or things that mean something to them. Maybe they're more likely to be the ones to exhibit those behaviors. But yes, people do feel this way. Does everyone feel this way? No. Do growing groups of consumers feel this way? Yes. And, you know, year over year, as we have these kind of conversations, I know on the beauty side, we've been talking about these issues in particular for probably at least 5 or 6 years now. I mean, we've even gone so far as to create some trends that we did quite a few years ago, Campaign Capital being one of them, talking about, you know, brands, instead of riding the line, because I think, and Johnny, I'm sure, has an opinion on this too, but I think traditionally there's been this kind of, you know, you see it during like Oscar speeches and somebody takes the podium and uses their platform and everyone goes, oh, shut up, just be in the movies. That's really starting to change. Now people say, no, I want to know not just what your product is, but who you are as a company and who the people are behind it. Because if that doesn't make sense to me, then why am I going to put my dollars in that particular place? I'm going to put my dollars somewhere else that makes sense for me as an individual.
You mentioned Gen Z, and if at the moment it's younger consumers, well, they're not very big purchasers of products, I guess, overall.
Could I jump in? Could I just jump in with that?
Go on,
Gen Z, because yeah, I've done some work on Gen Z in food and drink, and I was fascinated, you know, reading about how they're so right on and how, you know, it's really important that brands support their values. The data doesn't back it up. You know, when you look at what really drives their purchase for food and drink, it's taste, convenience, and value. And not only just by a little bit, but by a long, long way. So I think this is a generation that definitely likes to think of themselves as good people and right on. But I think often this issue gets overblown because the media really jump on it. And when you really look at like hard, cold figures, and when someone's standing in a supermarket and they've got 2 or 3 seconds or less to decide what brand they want, are they thinking about those brand values? Maybe a tiny bit, but I think it is quite a small bit. I think much more they're thinking, actually, can I afford that? You know, is that going to be tasty? And then there's a little bit about, you know, do I like the brand, and ethics plays into that. But I think that brands need to be really, really careful that they don't think this is more important to consumers than it actually is.
Definitely, especially with Gen Z or Gen Z, because there, you know, there's the income situation there, right? They don't have the disposable income. So if you're talking about products outside of food and drink, products that are a little bit more, you know, aspiring, if you will, you know, they don't have the disposable income. And then when you are talking about, you know, things that are more, you know, important, such as food and beverage, where you have to eat and you have to drink, but cost is a huge, you know, factor. Is it convenient? Is it sold somewhere that I, you know, pass by every day? So yeah, I definitely agree with you, Johnny, there in terms of not putting more, you know, into something that it's really not, because, you know, you got to talk about, you know, where the money is and people putting their money where their mouth is.
Yeah. And I think brands are sort of forgetting what their role is, you know, and again, I'm talking from a food and drink perspective. Your role is to provide people with a really tasty product that's really good value. That is your role. That's what you should be thinking about. And yes, there are some other elements, and Sarah's right, that it's become more important to consumers over time, the ethics of the company, but it's still very, very small, the amount of influence that factor has in decisions.
And I don't know if maybe beauty is just a little bit different, because there are so many brands out there that are doing the exact same thing as another brand. And so if you're, you know, if you've got two products sat on the shelf, they're identical in terms of what they're delivering on, what the price is, blah, blah, blah. But one of them, you know, is owned by a woman or owned by a minority or something like that, people might just go, ooh, you know what? That's the one that I want to support. And so they're not making a sacrifice there in terms of, you know, performance or anything like that, but they're able to kind of say, you know, I'm just trying to be a little bit more conscious about those purchases and sort of implementing some of that. And then going back to Gen Z or Gen Z, you know, hopefully they're doing a good job of educating their parents, right? Because the parents ultimately are the ones that are spending the money, unless they're giving them this exorbitant allowance and sending them on their way, which is hopefully unlikely. But, you know, I mean, I'm Gen X, and, you know, we are the parents of the Gen Zs. And I think just from the people that I know kind of in that group, we do learn a lot from the kids. You know, they really do kind of educate us on things and shout us out when we're, you know, making poor decisions. Not all the time, obviously, but at least some of the time.
So straight off the bat, we're already talking about consumers, that you've almost implied that taking a stand at the moment is still a cherry on top. You must not forget the taste, the value, the convenience, it can be branding, but if you lose the rest, you're still unlikely to succeed?
Well, the day you're buying a product, you know, I mean, the product still has to deliver, because that's where you're spending your money. So, yeah, you still got to have the right, you know who your consumer is, give them what they want. And then, you know, the rest of it becomes a part of how you talk about it and how you position yourself or what your, you know, your public persona looks like.
What I think is interesting about what you're saying, Sarah, is the differences between beauty and food and drink, because I would say that beauty is always ahead of food and drink. So it's like a bit ahead of the curve on this. And I would also say that beauty is more about lifestyle than food and drink. So beauty maybe the closest cousin for food and drink is alcohol, say, for beauty. And is it the fact that for lifestyle brands, this kind of ethics is more important than it is maybe for brands that are more kind of everyday?
I mean, it's possible because you hear a lot of this conversation going on in fashion as well, which again, same kind of thing. Just this idea of, you know, consciousness and sustainability and looking after the planet and looking after the people that are making the products and all of that kind of a thing. So yeah, I mean, it's possible when someone, I mean, look, at the end of the day, beauty is not essential. You know, it's not essential for you to survive. If someone's going to chuck you out into the woods for 6 months to exist on your own, you taking a lipstick with you? No, but you're going to make sure that you have food.
I know some people that would, like my mum.
Okay, all right.
I'm totally taking a lipstick with
you. My mum still wears a lipstick under her face mask every time.
Clearly talking to the wrong group.
Yeah, I will find the chickpeas.
Ed would take a vat of hummus.
I would.
It's this idea of essential items versus things that you are actively spending thinking about purchasing, not because it's going to sustain your body. A big part of beauty is the advertising. And all of this stuff that we're talking about, taking a stand and having a position and you know, how do you project yourself as a company? That's all part of that. And from a beauty perspective, that's what sucks people in. And the product has to then hold up its weight in order for the person to want to slap down those dollars, if that makes sense.
You're projecting an ethical lifestyle on you. And I think that's more powerful in beauty than it would be in food and drink.
Yeah. And then people talk about it and they share pictures of it and it goes in that way.
Okay. So I want to just shift to one more consumer stat, still focus on consumers before we get, this will link nicely into brands. We asked UK consumers a question and half of them, which for me felt like a lot, but you'll tell me what you think. Half of them said they're prepared to boycott companies who behave unethically, obviously based on their opinion, the consumer opinion, they behave unethically. You know, really? Half?
Prepared to. That's the key. It's, I think,
a caveat,
those are the key words in that stat.
Yeah.
Absolutely. It's they're prepared to, but are they doing it?
Yeah, what you're prepared to do versus what you actually do are two totally different things.
There's a lot of mainstream brands that are very, very good value that, you know, their ethical practices have been questioned and yet they continue to do very good business. So yeah, I would question the reality of that.
Okay. So we're already trying to get this understanding of this virtue signaling versus, you know, taking a stand for the right reasons. But I think now it's worth looking at brands. Consumers might put out their own, you know, virtues online to their friends, whatever it might be. But should brands do it? Let's start with that. Should they even bother, or should they just leave this stuff aside? Is it worth it?
I think in most cases, it's not worth it. And I think Nike is almost the exception that proves the rule. And I think Nike were different because they were ahead of it. It's very rare for brands to be ahead of it. I don't think it's worth it personally. I think maybe if you're a small brand, you can use it as a way to differentiate yourself. But for me, business and politics have never been mixed for a very good reason. And I don't see any reason to change that position.
It's totally worth it as long as whatever the cause is or whatever statement they're making aligns with what their original business is or their business practices. So, for example, you know, if you are, say, for instance, a company that manufactures household cleaning products. And you've, you know, always, you know, the nature of your product is to be environmentally safe and sustainable and things of that nature. You know, and then something happens, you know, things happening every day, obviously, but if there was some big thing that happened where, you know, there was an oil spill or something like that, it would make sense for that company to make a statement because that statement is always true to what that brand has always been and has always done.
It's authentic and consistent. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Mm. So, I mean, there are cases that I see where it does work if it aligns with the culture and the brand of that company to begin with.
And I think that's the challenge. I think in some of what we have seen happening in the marketplace is people, you know, companies coming out of left field and standing up for something. And you're like, hang on a minute. You know,
it really jars. Yeah.
Yeah. Cause people just kind of look at that and go, well, where were you when this was happening or where that was happening? And then that becomes the focus of the conversation. But, you know, we have this great, sort of campaign, this sort of nonprofit group that started sort of last year when the whole Black Lives Matter movement really, you know, took center stage. And all of these beauty brands were coming out with these, you know, social media posts and all of this messaging around the movement and showing their support, et cetera, et cetera. And this group of kind of industry insiders kind of got together and said, hold on a second. And they started calling brands out. So they used Instagram as their kind of platform of choice. It's pull up for change. And basically they said, let's take some examples of these brands that are sharing this messaging and kind of shine a spotlight on them and say, like, put your money where your mouth is. Show us your diversity statistics. Show us the demographic breakdown of your C-suite. And a lot of companies delivered. And they gave them that information and said, share it publicly. We want people to know where we are today because we're willing to make a commitment to change. And, you know, a year later or however far on we are from when that initially started, brands are still providing that information and saying, hey, we made this commitment. We're going to keep measuring ourselves and showing you what we're doing. So I guess basically what I'm saying is there's a possibility that you can sort of put a stake in the ground if it's not something that you've had a position on before and use it as a way to kind of pivot and say, hey, we know we haven't always done the right thing, but today, like the change starts today.
We're trying now.
Yeah, exactly. And if you're kind of open and honest, I think Johnny already said, if you do it in an authentic way, and, you know, Adia talked about this too, if it's part of your kind of DNA and it really does go sort of company-wide or across your whole organization, then it's okay to kind of change tack if it makes sense and if it's the right thing to do.
Trouble is, you're setting yourself up for trouble. So say if you take BrewDog as an example, and they've done some really good things in terms of sustainability, and then suddenly they were called out on Twitter as not being an employer that, you know, people really wanted to work for. So you are really kind of setting yourself up, and that's the issue I have with it. So I think you almost can't win.
I mean, you'd like to think that those call outs would be a catalyst for change, but I guess in not all.
Yeah, and they've been, you know, they reacted in the right way. They've been very humble and been very open to change. But even so, you know, the damage is done to an extent.
Similar to the Gillette one I mentioned at the beginning, they were challenged on the price of women's razor blades,
pink tax
after the Gillette, and that was a big topic that came out of that one, right?
Mm-hmm. Yeah, because, you know, we've been talking about this idea of this pink tax for years, and we started to see all of these new brands coming into the shaving space that were all direct to consumer, great pricing, didn't matter what your gender was or how you identified. If you needed a razor, you could get it at this great price. And then, you know, you still had these big brands that have been out there sort of dominating the space for eons, doing the exact opposite. And people are going to say something about it, especially when there is an alternative out there that's doing better.
So I'm going to throw a question to Adia, because we're getting into that topic of should we bother if you're a company? I'm going to ask you directly, should we bother? And you're in a position where you say we should, and we are. But should they bother?
Yeah. Well, I mean, Mintel, obviously, as a global leader in the market research insights category, you know, we, you know, service all of these various brands, right? And we, you know, specialize in giving them the best information in order to make their business decisions. So in the same case, we were almost in the same boat as them as well. Even though we're a global company, you know, with over 48 nationalities speaking over 37 different languages, there was definitely an issue within our organization in terms of truly being diverse, not just racially, ethnically, you know, gender-wise, orientation, you know, disability, and all of these various dimensions of diversity, as well as, you know, we had to look at ourselves in terms of being equitable and inclusive and, you know, really providing a culture of belonging at our own organization. And so that really required us to, you know, begin to look inward. And when we, I mean, when George Floyd was murdered in the US, and I'm US based, and I'm actually based in Chicago. So, you know, my city went up in flames, you know, for lack of a better phrase, right before our eyes. And that's where our US headquarters are located. And so Mintel has always practiced the notion of our people being our largest asset and really being our brand. I mean, you guys are our brand. You're the ones who write the content and give the, you know, the insight to our clients. And so that was kind of where we went first. How are our people doing? Okay, so this is happening in Chicago. This is our global, you know, our US or America's based headquarters, you know, what is happening with our employees? What is happening with our people? And that was kind of what catapulted the decision for Mintel to look inward and to really begin to design and strategize a diversity, equity, and inclusion program. So it wasn't about branding per se, or, you know, about us selling anything. It was really about, these are our people. How do we protect them? How do we now begin to create safe spaces now that we understand that this is what's been going on in their lives all of this time? And how do we do that? How do we do that genuinely and authentically?
You're saying how you prevent it from just being Mintel's tick box on diversity. Thumbs up. We've got Adia.
Definitely. Yeah.
the critical distinction is between actually driving that change organizationally and using it as a branding tool. And I know Adia agrees with this, that, you know, it's when you use it for branding, and often in a way that is virtue signaling, and you use it, you know, you certainly appear as a company to be more interested in telling people how great you are rather than actually driving change. That's the issue.
And information is so readily available now. I mean, you know, you mentioned earlier that, you know, you can go on Twitter and an employee can actually go out and put out a tweet, or, you know, you can find out who the CEOs or CFOs are of organizations.
Yeah, there's no hiding.
Go back through their Instagram and see all of that. And so
you know what they've said in the past, and they've come out.
People are very good on the internet. You can find anything. That's it. You know, the old tweets and nothing disappears. Yeah.
They're little researchers on their own, right? And so as a research company, we definitely had to make sure that, like, the change started within us and us looking inward and seeing the opportunities for growth. But back to your direct question, though, Ed, in terms of how to make sure we're not a tick box, right? That's actually part of my job. Because when I took the job, believe you me, even my own social network, when I announced, you know, I had accepted the position, you know, they were already calling me a tick box. And these are my friends. These are people that I know, or supposedly my friends. And so instead of, you know, running away from that, you know, I embrace that as, you know, that could be. And there probably are a lot of organizations out here that are ticking the box. And so that has to be part of my job, to keep our organization accountable. It's my job and the job of people that are in, you know, the diversity suite, you know, whether they be at C-level or their manager, director, associate level, or what have you, to keep that organization accountable for what they say. If you've made this grand statement like Black Lives Matter or what have you, okay, so now what are we doing 3 months, 6 months, 12 months, 18 months, 2 years later that shows within our organization Black Lives Matter?
And that's it. accountability, right? Who's keeping tabs on these companies, you know, to make sure that they're not just doing it in like a performative way or as a branding stunt or something like that. I think it's the, again, going back to the authenticity and, you know, not doing it in a way where you're, you know, you're so self-righteous because look at me, I have an opinion and aren't I important? It's not about that. You know, it's really not about being pretty or whatever.
What's interesting is, though, there are companies that are beginning to hold each other accountable. So like supplier diversity is like a huge thing now. I mean, it's been going on, obviously, since at least in the US since the 1950s. However, there's a resurgent now. So we have clients that are, you know, sending surveys and questionnaires that we have to fill out in terms of what our supplier diversity looks like and then what our overall diversity programs look like. So there's definitely, I think we're going to see an uptick in terms of companies and brands that may be in the same categories or competing with each other, having the ability to kind of keep each other accountable for the things that they say that they're doing, you know, in that space.
On that, and I'm going to throw this at Johnny because I think he'll have a really great opinion on this. At what point do you say to a supplier or a client, you know, we're an agency, that their morals and values don't suit you as a company? Should we as companies be saying we don't want you? Or actually, is there a line? Should you only be looking in? What do you think? Bit of a question. A curveball for you.
What a question. I think that's dangerous. I mean, yes, you want to have your own values, but also I think you want to be tolerant of other people's values. I think at the moment there's a lot of intolerance and there's a lot of you with companies that are, you know, being more woke, that there is, you know, a one fits all set of values and that there isn't. You know, if you look at Brexit, for example, that divided the nation is virtually a 50-50 split. If you look at the Trump versus Biden vote, that's a virtually a 50-50 split. So I think it's important to have values and know who you are. But I think it's really dangerous if you start to then say, you know, we're not going to deal with companies just because they don't agree with our values, because, you know, that values, that there is not an objective set of values in the world.
Okay. So From that place, have we got some fabulous success stories where they've taken a stand, even if it's one or two that you can think of, where they've taken a stand? And we've mentioned Nike, and you're welcome to talk more about it. But and it's come up trumps commercially, and it was the right move for that organization. It fit. It really were, you know, made a lovely circle around their image that they already had.
I mean, I can give you, I won't name anyone specifically, but I think for beauty, we've seen a real shift in some of what has been going on in the retail space. So, you know, one of the things that we've seen in the last few years is just this explosion of these independent brands and these you know, small owned brands, and they've really kind of taken over the beauty space. And so one of the things that they have done from the very beginning and done really well is a personality and really showcase the people behind the brand and who they are and what they stand for and their values, and really use that to exemplify who they are as a brand. And there's so many of them. That's why I'm not going to throw out any names, because there are so many examples of it, but they've taken the category by storm. And a big part of that, and just, you know, we've got this in the data, but just from conversations I've had as well, a big part of their success is the fact that they do have this identity, and it's about more than just the product. And then following on from that, in response to a lot of the shifts that we've seen over the last year or so related to, you know, diversity and representation, et cetera, some of the big beauty retailers have said, we're pledging to allocate a certain percentage of our shelf space to women-owned brands, Black-owned brands, minority-owned, whatever it might be, and really starting to make a concerted effort to make sure that their product assortment matches with the product assortment that the shopper wants to see. And that's been generating a lot of conversation and a lot of really great sort of positive kind of PR for a lot of these brands and retailers. So it's been nice to watch.
We've got a bit of a circle though, right? By what you're saying, because at the beginning we talked about how do consumers even care, and really they say they do, but whether it really matters on the ground, and yet the brands are still doing it.
But up front I did mention this idea of, is it accessible and convenient for people to get their hands on, especially from a beauty perspective? People aren't going to order something online and wait 6 weeks for it to show up because it's something that they can't get readily. So that's why when you see these big retailers making those shifts and becoming a bigger part of that conversation and making these brands and products accessible to people, I think that just broadens the whole scope of that 60-whatever% that says that they would like to buy from brands that align with their values. That makes it easier for them to actually act on that. You know, this I'm prepared to crowd, right, can actually enact on what it is that they're saying if that stuff is there for them and they can get it.
I just want to ask, what's next? How far does this go? And what are we expected to see over the next few years? Who wants to go first? Adia, do you want to kick us off and then our beauty and food guys?
I think we're going to definitely see more brands decide to take a stand or actively not decide to take a stand based on, you know, internal intelligence that they have, you know, on how it could affect positively or negatively their business. I think that we're going to just see a lot less kind of impulse reaction to things that happen in the world, because I think brands are really going to think about it a lot more. So whether they decide to take a stand and say, you know, I'm against this or I'm for this, or whether they decide to be quiet and say nothing, I think that we're going to see a lot less reactiveness and more, you know, perhaps proactiveness or absolutely nothing at all. But we're definitely going to see a lot less people just jumping on the bandwagon. That's what I think.
I'll jump in there as well, because I hope that Adiette's right, because I think we've seen a lot of panic, for want of a better word. But I think that, you know, the fact that you know, businesses have been made to think about this is good, and it will, you know, force certainly more focus on sustainability from companies, more deep focus on sustainability, which will be really, really good. But yeah, I would hope from a commercial perspective that rather than just react, companies will really take the time to understand their audience as much as they understand themselves and align their views towards that audience rather than just making a lot of assumptions about that audience.
Yeah, and I would echo a lot of that. I think that the most important thing, whether you're a huge brand or a tiny brand, is who's your consumer? You know, knowing the demographics of your consumer, what part of the world they're in, what age they are, what they're educated, you know, all of that, really understanding what they react to and what they don't react to is a big part of it, because you could have this sort of knee-jerk reaction to some big issue that's going on in the world and then ultimately alienate 85% of your consumer base because you haven't really thought about who those people are and where they live. So hopefully, you know, from my perspective within the beauty space, I think we will continue to see more of this idea of brands with a purpose. Now, whether that is to give back to the local community, support the environment, you know, focus on diversity, inclusivity, you know, gender represent, whatever it might be, we're continuing to see more and more of that happening, but it's happening in a more thoughtful way. And people are kind of taking the time to say, okay, this is something that we think is really important, but let's take a little bit of time to figure out the right way to sort of get in there and go after it, or if it's even the right thing to do.
Also, issues like sustainability are clearly very, very important. You know, I know that's a political issue, but it is hard to argue that that's not important. But there are other things like political beliefs that I think are less important and people are less likely to agree on. So I would like to see businesses focusing more on the eco stuff and less on the political stuff.
My dad has a very a phrase that he always loves to say, and he says, those in glass houses shouldn't throw stones. And being the idea that, and I'm going to use another phrase, that you are what you eat, or in this case, you need to be what you eat. And I think that I felt like two nice little phrases sum this up a little bit, that if you're going to take a stand and not going to be caught virtue signaling, you need to really look into yourself before you do it. And that seems to be the big conclusion here. And sometimes it's the right move, because actually commercially it could work out very well for you, but you have to do that internal analysis. Thank you very much, Adia, Sarah, and Johnny. This has been really interesting. It could have gone in many directions, because I've had many conversations with you guys before. But we've got to go close there. So to everyone else, thank you very much for listening. As you always do, please subscribe and rate and review and listen to these guys again and again on all the platforms that you get your podcast from. So, please come back next time, or check on mintel.com for some of our articles and our blogs. Check us out on LinkedIn and Instagram and Twitter and Facebook. We're on the socials, and you see all the amazing webinars that our guys are doing as well. Many thanks for listening.